Hello, this is Mario from ODEON. In this video, we will explain the theory of binaural auralisation, which is auralisation over headphones. An auralisation is a realistic simulation of how a specific audio would sound in a real or virtual room. In the case of a real room, this would allow us to listen to how different audio stimuli would sound if played in the room, without having to physically produce the sound in that room. When listening to auralisations, it should be done over headphones. The reason why will be explained later in this video. Auralisation has even more advantages in virtual rooms, as it allows us to estimate the acoustics of a room before it has been built or before implementing a proposed acoustical treatment. Listening to the simulated acoustics gives a more relatable experience of the acoustics of a room, compared to looking at numbers such as reverberation time and strength. This is especially useful when presenting your project to a client who does not have an intuitive understanding of acoustic parameters. An essential requirement for an auralisation is the room impulse response. This is the waveform that would be produced when playing a theoretical delta Dirac, or impulse, in the room. This waveform will be the acoustic identity of the room, including properties such as the reflections in the room, thus the reverberation time, as well as the frequency response of the room. However, one should keep in mind that the room impulse response is also dependent on the source and receiver positions. Moving the source or receiver to a different position will yield a different impulse response. The impulse response of a real room can be measured via different methods. We have a video explaining the sine sweep method, which is one of the currently preferred methods. For virtual rooms, the impulse response can be simulated using room acoustic simulation software. One such software is ODEON, which uses hybrid methods combining ray tracing and image sources. We also have a video describing these methods in more detail. Of course, the room model should be accurate enough to obtain a realistic impulse response. However, whether this is done for a real or virtual room, the produced impulse response will be monaural by default, meaning the signal only has one channel. For a realistic simulation of acoustics, it is necessary to mimic human hearing, which is binaural. For clarification, stereo simply means two audio channels, while binaural audio also accounts for other factors involved in human hearing, such as reflections from the shoulders, the shape of the ears, and the time and level differences between ears. These factors contribute to our 3D perception of sound, so by including them, binaural audio can reproduce a realistic listening experience. For real rooms, this is typically achieved by recording with a dummy head instead of a microphone. A dummy head has microphones inside the artificial ears. When the sound is recorded in this manner, the effects of the human body on the incoming sound are recreated, such as the time and level differences and the reflections from the shoulders. The resulting impulse response is called a binaural room impulse response. For simulated rooms, a head-related transfer function, or HRTF, is applied on the reflections arriving at the receiver. This HRTF is, essentially, a pair of filters describing the frequency and phase response at each ear, depending on direction of sound arrival. For example, a sound coming from your left will be better perceived by your left ear than your right ear, as your head creates a shadowing effect, especially at high frequencies. In an HRTF, this is represented by a difference of at least 6 dB between ears above 1 kHz. So, we can think of an HRTF as a virtual dummy head. Having applied an HRTF, we obtain a simulated binaural room impulse response. One should keep in mind that dummy heads and HRTFs represent the physical characteristics of an average person, while realistically, different people have different bodies. However, dummy heads and HRTFs are still fairly accurate as general approximations. Once we have the real or virtual room's binaural impulse response, the final requirement is an anechoic recording. This is an audio of a recording made in a highly absorbent room, preferably an anechoic chamber. The reason why we need the recording to be anechoic is so that it doesn't also include the acoustics of the room where it was recorded. Otherwise, the auralisation will stack the acoustics of two different rooms. The anechoic recording and the binaural room impulse response are combined through a mathematical operation called convolution. It consists of first multiplying all samples in signal A times all samples in signal B, adding time delays according to the time of each pair of samples, and summing all the resulting signals together. This is the same principle as a multiplication of two polynomials, where the variable's power can be related to the time delay in convolution. If we convolve the anechoic recording with a monaural impulse response, then the anechoic recording inherits the acoustics of the room, most notably the reverberation time and the frequency response. However, this is not yet a binaural auralisation. For that, we need to convolve with the binaural impulse response instead, in order to also include the factor of human perception. Here, the anechoic recording is convolved individually with each channel of the binaural room impulse response, yielding a new two-channel signal. And this audio is what we call an auralisation. So, the auralisation will be a realistic simulation of how the anechoic recording would sound in the room, as if we were standing in the receiver position and facing the receiver's specified direction. We should keep in mind that the binaural impulse response is recorded or simulated at the ear positions. Therefore, the appropriate way to listen to binaural auralisations is with headphones. Additionally, in this way, you avoid adding the acoustics of the room you're currently in when listening to the auralisation. You should keep in mind that your headphones have a certain frequency response, which will give the auralisation some coloration, that is, an alteration to the timbre. We would recommend you to use headphones with a frequency response as flat as possible. Additionally, in ODEON, you could apply a filter that's the inverse of the headphone's frequency response, which will neutralize the coloration introduced by the headphones. In this video, we covered binaural auralisation. However, an alternate method of producing auralisations is with ambisonics on a speaker setup. We explain the theory of ambisonics in another video. With that, we conclude this video, and we hope you have found it useful.